Good morning, Mr. Javadi. Welcome to the channel, Trial Talk, Clinical Research Simplified. I'm Sunit, and it's a pleasure to have you here discussing about your journey in the industry. So for the audience, Mr. Javadi is Director of Medical Affairs in Embecta, and he's been in industry for quite some time, and he will be sharing his insights with us. So Mr. Javadi, can you please share with us your journey to becoming a Medical Affairs Director, and what inspired you to pursue this career?
Sure, yeah, thank you for this opportunity and give me this time to share some of my experience. It's a pleasure to be here. So like many of my peers in medical medical affairs, I started my journey through academia. At one point in my life, I was focusing on becoming actually a professor at university. So I was doing some research and getting into actually doing my PhD in neuroscience. That was actually what I was in love with at the time and feel like that's the future. And then when you get closer to graduation, you try to think about the future and how you can use your skills in different opportunities. And then there are some facts that come into play, that the academia is not as open and accessible. It's saturated. There are many people that wanted to be part of it. And also, it's not we probably have some other idea about academia. When you get closer, you feel like that it's not very close to that. And then you try to look into why did you want it to be part of the research and academic aspects in life science. I get to this respond to myself that I want to be impactful. I want to have some impact in life of people. And then industry was another option for that. So I feel like, okay, how about using my skills and knowledge in industry? And then the first step for that was I wasn't familiar with industry. So how can I know more about industry? So I started to talk with people that was working at industry. And at the time, they recommend I do an internship. So it was close to my end of my PhD. I was writing my thesis and I said, okay, while I'm writing my thesis, I will do actually some internship in the industry. And then that was the start. I start working at industry full time as intern and writing my thesis during the evenings and weekends, which goes very fast. It was tough few months, but I submit my thesis on time, never put it back for, okay, I will do it at one time, and earn some experience in industry. And then from that point on, I get into industry and try to have my first contractual job and then permanent jobs, and then get from that point on to the next levels.
Okay, all right. So for those who might not be familiar, could you please explain what a medical affairs professional does and what your role as a director entails?
Sure. So medical affairs is one of the key pillars of a life science, pharmaceutical, medical technology, or biotechnology industry. In a way, you are a bridge between commercial side and the R&D. So at R&D, what you're doing is you are doing the direct research in a way to manage and develop the molecules, phase one, phase two, phase three, or devices. So if it is pharma, you're working on molecules, they are mainly life science people. And if it's device, there are lots of engineers. On the commercial side, an already developed, approved, and cleared product is going to be commercialized. Now, in between these two, to transfer that knowledge, that deep knowledge, to the commercial side, and also to prevent any non-acceptable claims about the product, medical affairs is always standard to make sure, first of all, what is share the learning and simplify that from R&D to commercial and to customers. Make sure that what commercial wanted to actually do with the product is you can be able to substantiate it, and also to do some further data generations to go and see how the product works in real life. What are the needs outside from patients and from the customers that you can go and find out in the research or run a new research and try to see the answer for that? So I would say that this is a bridge between commercial and R&D, and it is the hub of patient voice. So to hear something from the patient and try to patients and providers, the HCPs, and bring it to the company, to R&D and to commercial, to make sure that we are doing what is needed out.
Thank you. So would it be correct to assume that the medical affairs also helps like get the opinions of the key opinion leaders in the industry, who are like the physicians who are prescribing, and also make them aware about the new products that are on the market?
Definitely, as a part of actually our activity, if I want to actually talk about different section of medical affairs, depends on how large or small the company is. One of them are the MSLs that are the key people to communicate and share the education with healthcare providers. In a way, a healthcare provider out there working with so many different subjects and drugs and devices that doesn't have the that not all of them have time to be on top of the new data and new products out there. An MSL will be the person who is scientist, who have the scientific background, and can go to these people and start talking about it and tell them, okay, have you heard about this new publication? And start a discussion. And since these people are spending all their time on this specific subject, they are an added value to the healthcare professionals in terms of those specific topics. The other part of the medical affairs is data generation side of it, that we try to generate new data, whether going to the databases or running new trials, to answer some of the questions that probably come up during those discussions or during the insights that we are gathering. And then, of course, listening to the HCPs and healthcare providers is not limited to MSLs. We are having several advisory boards. We are inviting them and asking them the questions very directly, that, okay, how do you think about this? Why do you think, what is the gap out there? How do you feel like that we can actually fill in that gap? What are the hurdles you have in your job? How can us help some of those hurdles that eventually will help patients? And in a way, try to be a key contributor and supporter of this patients and healthcare providers.
Okay, thank you. The next question is, what does a typical day look like for you and your team?
What I love about medical affairs is there is no typical day. So I cannot tell you that I'm waking up in the morning. Of course, one of the things that I definitely do is I open my email and try to go through my emails. That's the only typical day of a medical affairs, that you check your email regularly, and there are so many of them. But beside that, I can probably have an annual routine than a daily routine, because on an annual routine, you start the year with a strategic planning. So bring all the team together, make sure that actually they are aware of the gaps, what is needed out there, what are the inputs from the HCPs and patients that we need to actually cover. Then we start to planning our data generation plan, our MSL communication plan, our medical education plan. And then based on those plans, we try to identify the key congresses and then plan projects towards the congresses, plan projects toward the publications, and plan the projects towards the clinical studies or data generation plans. And since each of them have different stages, you don't have a daily routine. So you start from identifying actually the databases or vendors, identifying actually the key opinion leaders, start planning for that, administrative works, then start to actually do literature research. So every day and every week is different from the other one. And that's actually the loveliest thing that I had from the medical affairs side, which made me feel alive, and every day is a new day.
Have you seen that the role of a medical affairs professional has evolved over the years in the pharma industry?
It does, actually. I can say that probably initially the medical affair was a small shop out there that whenever other functions had questions about the product or about the disease state or scientific aspects of that, they go there and ask the question. So it was kind of the advisor sitting inside the company. So people go and ask their questions. And then from that point to become a strategic pillar for the whole company, it was a great leap, I can say, because we did, now, I mean, the strategic planning of the whole company, for all those strategic planning, medical affairs is a key pillar. We are actually do our strategic annual planning, and we are part of that strategy because we are the hub of listening to patients, bring actually the gaps to the company, and then also try to make sure that everybody is compliant in a way that answer to that gap and unmet need out there. So, and I mean, there are several articles out there. For example, the McKinsey recently actually published something for the vision of medical affairs until 2030. And when you look at it, you will see that this role become more and more bold and important. And of course, one of the other reason is the pharma and the medtech industry is a very regulated and compliant platform. And the more compliant and regulation, compliant rules and regulation that is put in place, medical affairs become actually more and more important because it's limited the way and the paths of communication, which medical affairs is there to make sure that all of them are compliant, and at the same time, like, we can substantiate it based on the scientific data and evidences.
Thank you. So what are the biggest challenges a medical affairs professional faces, and how do you address those in your organization?
So, I mean, the challenges are really depends on, there are case by cases. I cannot tell you that there is actually a threat or biggest challenges out there that you cannot, that we are worried about it. I think there are still some companies that moving from advisor to strategic partner is a challenge for them. I remember years ago, it was actually a challenge. I still see in some of the companies that it is a challenge, but those companies are rare these days. They all of them consider the value of medical affairs, but educating the internal team is one of those probably challenges that how important a medical affairs can be. And I think a part of that is to my peers, to do this education and to show actually this value to the companies. Beside that, I think to measure and communicate the value of medical affairs is also a challenge. And one of the reasons for that is in commercial, the way that you measure the KPI is based on sales and numbers. So you know your target is X, and then you better met X, or you overachieve it, or you underachieve. So it's very easy to put it on a slide. They can say that, okay, we had X, we are X plus one, everybody will cover you, or we are X minus one, and everybody will actually encourage you, encourage you to do it next time. Now, on medical affairs, it's not easy to measure the impact of what you're doing because it's not something easily measurable. You try to educate the community. You can say that I had 10 webinars and 2 symposiums, but you cannot say actually what was the impact of that 10 webinars and 2 symposiums. Sometimes you try to indirectly actually get some impact out of it, like 2,000 people actually listen to this. So is that 2,000 people listening to this subject made any change in their practice? You don't know. And there are ways, we try to actually find ways to measure that, but you don't have a direct measure. And sometimes it makes it difficult to show the impact that this medical affairs team have.
So creation of annual strategies, that would be considered as an endpoint, right? Like when you have the feedback from the KOL and the patients, then you make changes in your budget and any, you know, the R&D, which direction it's going, what new products could we be working on. That would also show as an endpoint, like this is something as an impact to the industry, right?
It is, but again, if you do actually a survey before and after, and then you show actually there is a change, then you can show some impact. But if you are just doing that, okay, we hear that and we make these changes. Now, are we sure that the change that happened is because of medical affairs communication only? Is that actually, we just actually hear that and try to make some changes in our tactics and strategy? How does it impact? These are actually some of those aspects that is difficult to measure. But all of us have something like those surveys or before and after questionnaires. The MSLs ask some question at the beginning of their session with the HCPs and then continue to asking some others at the end of the visits. Let's say the third or second visit, and we try to actually measure something. But again, it's not as black and white as commercial or even R&D one.
So medical affairs educate healthcare professionals. So can you please elaborate a little bit on what exactly are the different strategies and ways, methods which are used to do that?
Can you repeat that question? Sorry.
Yeah, so the healthcare professionals medical affairs educate healthcare professionals, right? Go out in the community. So what are the, about new treatment and therapy? So what are the different various ways or methods which you achieve?
Yeah. So one of the key methods is the face-to-face one. That's the MSLs go and start to discuss with them. This is a classic method. Now, as you know, digital become more and more of a important approach to education and communication, especially after the COVID time. So we try to also use several digital platforms like webinars. So of course, for everyone, it's easier to listen to a webinar whenever they have time. Now, with these webinars, it can be completely industry supported, which there is no certification out of that, or it can be a certified education, which usually we provide a grant to a third party so that they can actually talk about the disease treatment. The other way are congresses. So congresses are the key points of education for many HCPs. And this means that we are supporting some symposiums or sessions, or we are submitting some abstract and papers to the congresses. So the congresses can, so people who attend Congress can actually go through it and actually learn about it. Also, we have some educational platforms. Educational platforms are the websites that we gather all these together and help HCPs who are interested in this specific subject to go there and find their way through the papers, webinars, symposiums, or anything similar to that.
Okay, all right, great. What advice would you give to someone looking to start a career in the medical affairs?
So I would say, try to decide about this earlier in your career or in your study period. If at the, I mean, if you know from the first day of your education, higher education, that you want to get into industry, it's, there are some complementary and some additional courses and learnings that you can have that is more related to industry. Knowing different techniques in lab is not as probably important for industry than knowing different part of the industry itself. Also, try to get as much as possible internship in the industry. This is not only because you learn about different positions. I mean, the first day that I got to industry, I had no idea about different positions available for inside medical affairs and beyond medical affairs. So, but by having internship, you will learn about different positions. It's not only MSLs. There are medical writers doing very good these days in terms of activities that they're supporting. You can be, I mean, I wasn't that much knowledgeable about health economic and HUR side and data generation aspects. So based on your interest, you can find some positions and then try to equip your tool belt with the skills that is needed for that specific position. So internship will, beside that, internship will actually bring you some networks, because it's always important to have network in the industry and with different people that are working in that industry. Not only because probably there is a position that they can offer you, but also they can share their experience with you. They can tell you what are the trends these days in medical affairs or outside of medical affairs in R&D so that you can educate yourself towards it. And the other point that I think it can be very helpful and is having a mentor. When you are having internship, you can probably ask some of the people who are in the industry to be your mentor. And and even when you get into industry, always try to choose a couple of people or at least one person who is a couple of steps further than you in his or her career to be your mentor. That helped me a lot because they share their experience. Sometimes you're actually stuck with a question or a situation, and those people who are not necessarily your direct report, you're not reporting to them directly, can be a good option. Also, if you are in industry, shadowing of another positions is also very helpful, because 80% of learning is on the job. So that's important to shadow some other positions and opportunity that you probably wanted to change or add to your skills.
Thank you. So what educational background and soft skills are required to excel in this role?
So in terms of the background education, I think if you are doing science, you usually will be able to manage a project in science. Not necessarily you need to have this exact same knowledge on the role that you're going to have in industry. My PhD was in neuroscience, but my whole industry experience was in diabetes. There was this little bridge from that, from what I was doing in PhD to diabetes, which actually bring me to that world. And I learned about literature research, educate myself on the subjects, and then try to be knowledgeable about the subject. And I can say that now I know way more than what I knew about neuroscience in diabetes because of all the learnings and continued education. So project management is a skill, and also that can help you on almost any position, and medical affairs is one of them. The other part, the soft skills, I think is very important. A hungry mindset is always welcome in any position you have. So when you have a team, there are proactive people that can find out that you can trust more on them. Usually if you are proactive, instead of just sitting and people ask you and then you try to deliver, then you'll have more chance of evolving and actually getting further and further in your position. The other soft skill is you be able to use communication skills. Communication skills in medical affairs and again in any other position can be a great added value, because sometimes you do a great job, but you never communicate on that. And when you learn well to how to market what you're doing, then your added value become obvious for everyone. And this is also an important skill. These days, digital become more and more bold. So having digital skills is very important. And this digital skills doesn't need to know Python language. That's not what I'm talking about. Mainly use the, first of all, aware of all the, or most of the softwares and tools that are available, and know how to use them, how to work with them. And this can be as easy as Microsoft Office, because there are people that they can't actually use that to the best of it.
They keep on changing it every year. Every year's a new edition of Microsoft Office coming in. Once you master the old one, there's a new one out there.
Go ahead.
So what is it like, do the medical affairs professional needs to have knowledge of the regulatory regulations as well as have marketing skills as well? Or what role do these two skills play in this?
So I think having knowledge on regulatory affairs is a very important added value for a medical affairs person, because you are working hand in hand with regulatory affairs, especially if there is a submission, if there is actually communication with actually agencies. So and in many companies, actually medical affairs and regulatory affairs are together. The structures are different. In some companies, R&D and medical affairs are together. In some companies, regulatory affairs and medical affairs are together. But it's not compliant at all that medical affairs and commercial affairs stay together in the same pillar. I've seen a couple of companies like that, but I think it's a very high risk and not acceptable. So for me, knowledge about the regulatory effort is more important than the knowledge on the commercial and marketing efforts. And the reason for that is usually you need to stick to the scientific and evidence approach than marketing effort. Now, if you were talking about having a knowledge of how to market and communicate on the evidence, I think that will be very helpful. I think it is a great skill in simplifying the evidence and science, visualize actually the numbers in a way that everybody can understand it. There is a lovely book called Information is Beautiful. The book is full of actually pictures, but it shows you how you can get data and visualize it in a way that people can easily go through the pages and learn. So those kind of skills, if you want to say that kind of marketing skills, I think it can be added value. But in general, in terms of how to market things, I don't think. But another skill which is important is finance, because when you are getting actually to a higher roles, one of the important things is budget management. And many of the scientists are probably not, at least life science people, are not as good on that. So knowing about budget management and also some financial actually skills will be helpful, not only on your career, but also in your personal life.
Thank you so much for that. What do you find most rewarding about your work as a medical affairs professional?
So, you know, on a daily basis, you're busy with the projects that will get actually to a point. You deliver, you make sure actually everybody in the team deliver on time. But the ultimate goal is what you're bringing to market and what you're actually bringing to the healthcare professionals will make the life of a person that is suffering from a disease easier. And when you're hearing from, let's say, a patient that they are, what is in the market actually make their life easier, you feel like you're not just delivering for a project, but you make a life of a person easier. And this is a big difference when you're working in pharma, medical related business, not specifically medical affairs, but pharmaceuticals, medical technology, than many other actually industries. Because of course, when you have a new car, which lots of engineers spend lots of time and deliver on time and take care of lots of projects, your life is easier, but it is very different from a person that is suffering and probably cannot have a normal life, but you try to help or make their life, you know, easier. So that's why sometimes when I sit with my friends who are in different industries, I feel like I have a little bit of better
job satisfaction.
Yeah, more job satisfaction. And it's not about the project that I love my job, but at the same time there is another point to that as well. Yeah,
we all take pride in being in healthcare and be able to help patients, so physicians, nursing staff, research, you know, it's all how do you inspire and lead your team in such a dynamic and complex way? It must be really challenging to get everybody on board, you know, be everybody on the same page and to get to the work together in collaboration. So
yes, I mean, what I love about the people management is the relationship, the person to person relationship. Because when you are a manager, you definitely have some responsibilities to run the business. So you're responsible for a sector and your team need to deliver something. And I think that's important, and you need to make sure that everything is on track, you're actually delivering. But on the other side, this is not the interesting part of management for me. The other side of it is important, which I make this personal relationship with people. I feel like that we are responsible for our team, for their career. It's like actually a coach or a teacher. Your teacher is responsible for finishing a curriculum, during that year. But you probably had some of those teachers that doesn't only that they don't only think about your only about that year. They're thinking about this year is a step towards your career, your life. And those are the teachers that stand out and always you have in mind, because probably until you get actually your diploma or get graduated, you had hundreds of teachers. But when I ask you, okay, who are those that you really remember? You probably come up with three or four, or maximum five of them, right? Because their goal was not delivering that year for you, but it was to be a right step to your future. And I think a good manager should be like that. That's actually my ultimate goal in my mind as a good manager, that I'm responsible regardless of if you have these people on board in this company or anywhere else to build this career and make sure that they are being educated. So, and this will actually make them to not, it make them change the mindset from, I just want to actually working here because I get my salary here, versus we're working here. Medical affairs work is not a 9-to-5 job. You're actually many times you work overtime. But at the end of the day, if they feel actually they are building their career and this is a step to their next step, I think it can be they will be engaged and have satisfaction. And the most challenging part is when you feel like that you can't do that for someone, because whether they are not interested or they don't have actually long-term vision. So that would be actually difficult to keep them engaged.
Yeah, that's I think the perfect approach to be a mentor to the, you know, to your colleagues. And that was very insightful. Thank you for sharing that. Could you please elaborate a little bit on what are the different roles within the medical affairs department? What are the different sub-departments that you're managing? Like, for example, you mentioned a couple, medical writing and the MSL. What are the other people?
Yeah. So medical education is also another important part of the medical affairs. So depends on how big the organization is, you can have actually medical education, which take care of, include actually several different people, and then they are taking care of webinars, symposiums, publications, because, for example, publication lead is another subject, another position in medical affairs that in some of the big companies, I mean, one of my previous role was head of scientific communication and publication. So we have publication lead in each of actually for each of the products, and those people taking care of all the papers, manuscripts, posters, abstracts, and everything related to that. Then there are people that are only responsible for, again, in big organizations, in advisory boards and symposiums. So they are taking care of KOL management. KOL means key opinion leaders and HCPs that are out there, and make sure that we are learning as much as possible from them, and we can actually work with them to educate other people that are probably not as knowledgeable as these people. So the medical education can be very big in some companies, because this is probably one of the most important things on medical affairs. On the data generation side as well, that's actually a part that can be large, and we can have statistician, biostatistician there as well to help doing some of those data generation, or to do some post-hoc analysis or sub-analysis of a trial that is being done. Usually the KIT trials of key registry trials are being done in a clinical affairs. Clinical affairs are usually people who are my peers that they just take care of those clinical trials. So from beginning, protocol development, make sure that it's executed correctly, and taking care of the initial analysis. But after the first paper and initial analysis, all the sub-analysis usually come to medical affairs, and medical affairs take care of it. The medical writing is something that we are using for those publication and Congress activity, and also slide development as well. Again, depends on the size of the company. You can outsource it or have it internally. So there are lots of medical communication company out there that are a good starting point for people who are just graduate from the university and they are good in writing. This is a great skills if you skill if you can if you have. They go to those companies and then they are supporting usually the industry for writing their papers or helping them to put slides together or document it or develop documents for them. Medical information is another pillar. Medical information is usually a place that when patients and HCPs have questions, there is an email or phone number that people should actually connect, and these people try to actually generate and develop standard responses, which is substantiated by the evidence and can easily refer to reliable publications out there and communicate with people. And we talk about it ourselves, of course.
Yeah, awesome. That's great. This medical affairs department collaborates with other department as well. You mentioned that regulatory affairs can work hand in hand, but not so much as the commercial sector. What other departments do you collaborate with?
So you always have collaboration with legal affairs because that's actually an important part, and make sure that we are setting the right lines for the company and make sure that everything is being done compliantly. The other part that we are working closely are access people. The access team is usually taking care of insurance relationship and government relationship, because when, you know, the first step is for you to make a drug available. So regulatory lead submission of that to the agencies, to the health authorities, get the approval. But when it become available, people should be able to access to that, because sometimes they're too expensive, or in countries like Canada, government should actually accept to reimburse it, because when you get Health Canada approval, it doesn't mean that it is available for everyone. It is available if you want to pay out of pocket, but to get accepted for reimbursement, then each province had actually different rules and regulation, which there is an access team that take care of that. It's the same, a little bit different in the US, because FDA is actually a little bit different and insurance is different there. So the access team also work with medical affairs to make sure that we are having enough material to convince insurances that they need to support this for the patients. And that's also the other step, which I think it's one of the very important aspects of a pharma industry and medical technology industry, because even if you have the best drug out there and people cannot afford having that, then nobody can actually benefit from it. But if you can make sure that insurances are covering that, then people can afford it and people can use it and you can see the impact.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. So so medical affairs is a sub part of R&D, or R&D is separate from medical affairs?
So it It depends actually on the structure of the company. In some companies, actually, the R&D, so if you're talking about pharmaceuticals, in some companies, R&D lead that and medical affairs is part of it. In some companies, actually, it is a separate one. So the CMO leading the medical affairs, and then the head of R&D leading actually the R&D section. There are companies that you have a CMO that taking care of both of them. In medical technology, you usually have better a CMO that is taking care of medical affairs and a CTO, chief technology officer, that taking care of R&D. In some companies, chief technology officer is leading both sides, so it means R&D and then medical affairs is actually part of it. So the structures are different. They are changing. I was part of the company that they changed their structure a couple of times, and people try to see what is the best approach. It also depends on the leaders that are leading those. So we are having actually the chief technology officers that are very knowledgeable on medical affairs, R&D, and technology side. So it's better that we have this alignment because it's easier to communicate between the two instead of actually having completely two different pillars. We have companies that the medical affairs lead, the CMO, chief medical officer, is knowledgeable about R&D, medical affairs, and all the other aspects. So this is a decision that usually the CEO take and depends on the leaders that they have and also consultants that they discuss with and the product that you want to bring to market. That's also a big portion of that.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for explaining that. So these are pretty much the questions from my side. Is there any parting message you want to give to our viewers?
I mean, probably it's a good idea I share some of the experience. It more than experience is what I heard from some of people in academia, that they have some hesitance of getting into the medical affairs or industry. And I could say, if I go back and become actually a young student at university that try to plan for my career, I would definitely, from the right off the bat, target industry. And the reason for that is I feel like that the impact that I have in industry is way higher than what I could have in academia. Also, I see actually the research that is being done in industry are way more regulated than what is being done in academia. So there are many people that have an eye on that for writing a protocol. It's not just two people that think about it. It's a big team that review and make sure that the protocol is correct and can be done. And also in terms of career development, there are so many different steps. So it's not just assistant professor, associate professor, and professor, dean. So you have so many other options. So I would, as a person that experienced this, I really encourage young university students or graduates to do some internship and test. Probably they like it. But on the other hand, never forget that the industry job is very different from academic job because you're working way it's never 9 to 5, so you continue working through, and your job and life is entangled. So that's something that you need to keep in mind.
Well, it was a pleasure to have you, and thank you for sharing these valuable insights and a peek into your journey into this position.
Thank you.
That was wonderful. Thank you so much once again, Mr. Javadi.
Nice talk to you. Thank you for having me. Bye.